हे कृष्णा करुणा सिंधो दीनबंधो जगतपते, गोपेश गोपिका कांत राधा कांत नमोस्तुते। तप्त कांचन गौरांगी राधे वृंदावनेश्वरी वृषभानुसुते देवी प्रणमामि हरि प्रिये। वांछा कल्पतरुभ्यश्च कृपा सिंधुवयैव च पतितानां पावनेभ्यो वैष्णवेभ्यो नमो नमः। जय श्री कृष्ण चैतन्य प्रभु नित्यानंद श्री अद्वैत गदाधर श्रीवासदि गौर भक्तवृंद। हरे कृष्णा 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 हरे हरे, हरे राम 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 हरे हरे। कूजन्तं राम रामेति मधुरं मधुराक्षरं आरुह्य कवितां शाखां वंदे वाल्मीकिकोकिलं। वाल्मीकेर्मुनिसिंहस्य कवितावनचारिणा शृण्वन् रामकथानाथं कोनयाति परमां गतिं। वेदवेद्ये परे पुंसि जाते दशरथात्मजे वेदप्राचेत दासीत् साक्षाद् रामायणात्मना। अञ्जनानन्दनं वीरं जानकीशोकनाशनं कपीशमक्षमन्तारं वन्दे लङ्काभयङ्करम्। मनोजपं मारुततुल्यवेगं जितेन्द्रियां बुद्धिमदां वरिष्ठं वातात्मजं वानरयूर्धमुख्यं श्रीरामदूतं शिरसा नमामि। आंजनेय मदिपाटलानां कांचनाद्रि कमनीय विग्रहं पारिजात तरु मूल वासिनं भावयामि भवमानंदनं। यत्र यत्र रघुनाथ कीर्तनं तत्र तत्र कृतमस्त कांचलिं बाष्पवारि परिपूर्ण लोचनं मारुतिं नमश राक्षसांतकम्। सो वेलकम एवरीवन टू द सेकंड डे ऑफ अयोध्या कांड। Today is such a glorious day throughout the Bharat Varsha, where everybody is celebrating the great auspicious day known as Akshaya Tritiya. So first and foremost, being one of the greatest days in the calendar of Vedic society, being one of the greatest days amongst the Vedic calendars, I would wish you all a very happy Akshaya Tritiya. On this day, in the past, there were numerous pastimes that had happened, and hence it is very important that we remember these pastimes on a daily basis. Some of the most prominent pastimes which happened during this time or this day was the great giving of Akshaya Patra. Akshaya means that which never ends, the bliss that never ends, which is always present. So this is the day when Yudhishthira prayed to Vivaswan by calling out 108 names of sun or Bhaskara. Like sun has many names. Sun, when I say it, is S-U-N, that is Divakar, Surya, Ravi, Prabhakara, Bhaskara, Suraj, and there are many other names of sun. In fact, one of the name is also Samvartaka, says Mahabharata. So there are many names of sun which he addressed, and by calling out the 108 names, sun himself came. And for 12 years, he handed over the Akshaya Patra to Yudhishthira. We all know the story that Akshaya Patra is one of the greatest vessels in which the person who is cooking, before she takes prasadam, if she mentally offers the mantra which is given by sun god, and she requests the Akshaya Patra to give the food, then it can give to any amount of people. It can feed and it can make others honor prasadam. So this way, today was the day when Akshaya Patra was given. And we know the great story between Krishna and Draupadi and Durvasa, how Krishna saved Pandavas from the wrath of Durvasa, who was sent by none other than Duryodhana. That happened. We also see Sudama and Krishna meeting in Dwaraka happened on Akshaya Tritiya. Some of the recent pastimes, such as Jagannath Puri's Ratha, gets started today. They start to make the Ratha today. In fact, there is a description of that also in the Puranas, where Brahma orders Indradyumna Maharaj to actually go and construct the Jagannath Puri Rath today, saying that Balabhadra's chariot should have 14 horses, Krishna's chariot should have 16 horses, and Subhadra's chariot should have 12 horses. So today the Rath of Jagannath Puri starts making today. So there are so many pastimes, like Ganges comes on Mother Earth, the birth of Ashwini Kumaras of Brahma. There is also for our ISKCON devotees a very wonderful place, because the League of Devotees was established by Srila Prabhupada in Jhansi during this Akshaya Tritiya day. It's also the great day of start of Chandan Yatra, and I can speak on, and it is such a beautiful day. And the reason it is such a beautiful day is because, as per Vedic astrology, the sun and the moon are at the right point of time where they are in the maximum peak values. And we see that the sun and the moon are most essential to provide us with food and vegetables, which constitutes the most sattvic ahar. The most transcendental bhoga is fruits, vegetables, little clarified butter, ghee, rice, and nice yogurt and milk. These are some of the items which Krishna likes very much. And Krishna loves to eat butter, Krishna loves to eat yogurt, milk, and all of these. So today is the day when, because of sun and moon, we get these wonderful tastes in these vegetables. We get nourishment from these vegetables. And we all know how much we can appreciate, especially during lockdown, when we have limited quantities, but we are relishing in those limited quantities, the food and the vegetables and the taste that we eat. Such is our Vedic culture that whenever we taste the water, whenever we taste the vegetables, whenever we taste food with clarified butter, we get a taste. And if we remember in that taste through our tongue, Krishna, that he has actually provided all these wonderful commodities for us to take for our nourishment of our body, and also giving us spiritual benefit, the natural tendency is gratitude. And we should never forget this gratitude towards the Lord. So today is the great day of origin of food, and today is a great day of Akshaya Tritiya. Because whatever we start on this day, it is said that it is a great place to start, because the benefit of that start is never ending. So those who are not chanting, it is a great day to start chanting. Those who are chanting 16 rounds, maybe it is a great day to chant one more round as your additional. Those who are reading Srimad Bhagavatam, it is good to read two more shlokas, because it is said that what we start, the benefit is there for us to continue. And it is not like our New Year resolutions, that we start on January 1st and it ends on January 3rd. So it is much more giving us the impetus. It is much more giving us the strength to carry forward. So one of the greatest qualities, as I said, is Akshaya, means that is never ending. Similar is the story of Ramayana. Whatever Valmiki has written in the 24,000 slokas, they are so beautiful that the depth of the meaning of those are Akshaya, which means they are never ending. They are so beautiful that we can keep on reading them again and again and again and draw newer meanings out of them on a day-to-day basis. So without further ado, we had left over yesterday where the kingdoms were very happy. The Janakpuri was very happy. Ayodhya was very happy. And the reason was Parashuram's anger was subsided. Balakanda had come to an end. Mother Sita and Lord Ramchandra both were arriving in the chariots. Both the Ayodhya Vasis and the Janakpuri Vasis were very, very happy. In fact, they had a transcendental competition, conversation amongst themselves to say, to see my Lord Ramchandra, you need 1,000 eyes. While as the Janakpuri Mithila Vasis, they said, every time Rama has to see Mother Sita, he has to have 1,000 eyes. So like this, all of them were very happy in the kingdom of Ayodhya or the Kosala kingdom, and they were staying there for 12 years very nicely together, says Valmiki, and he signs off the Balakanda. We saw yesterday that Balakanda in itself is 2600 shlokas that Valmiki had written. And when Valmiki had written these 2600 shlokas, he had covered around 24 years of Lord Ramchandra. However, now he is entering into Ayodhya Kanda. He is entering the second phase of his magnum opus work of Ramayana, which is Ayodhya Kanda, where he mentions the events of 1 week in 7,000 verses. And how does he start this great magnum opus work? He starts with a beautiful verse from Ayodhya Kanda. So let us just learn the verse which he starts in Ayodhya Kanda. It says, Gacchata matrakulam bharatena tadanaga shatrugno nitya shatrugno niti priti puraskritaha. You'll be very wondering that out of Ayodhya Kanda, Valmiki can describe many things, but the first shloka that he uses is the word gacchata. Gacchata matrukulam bharatena tadanaga. It is almost like the camera scene is shifting to two other characters, which people were seeing them on the stage, but they were not very much focusing on them. Who are those people? None other than Bharata and Shatrughna. So Valmiki is focusing on Bharata and Shatrughna, and he is saying, Gacchata matrukulam. They both went to their maternal father's place. That is their uncle's place, their maternal father, grandfather, their place. Matrukulam bharatena tad anagaha. That means one, the person who is always goes along with him to serve Bharata. Who is that? Shatrughna. Shatrughna, nitya shatrughno. When we spoke about the names of Shatrughna, we mentioned about this quality of Shatrughna, that Shatrughna is the person who has actually been victorious over his enemies. Who are his enemies? Externally, there is an enemy in Uttarakhanda. We mentioned him as Lavanasura. Other than that, internal enemies also Shatrughna has won over, which is Kama, Krodh, Lobh, Moh, Mad, Matsarya. Apart from that, our Acharyas also mention there is a Nitya Shatrughno. What is this Nitya Shatrughno? Nitya means always. So Shatrughna has to always battle a Shatru or an enemy. What is that Nitya Shatrughno? If the internal enemies are conquered, external enemies are conquered, what is the Nitya Shatrughno? Acharyas explain that Shatru is none other than Rama Bhakti. Now you might be thinking, how is Rama's devotional service a Shatru for Shatrughna? It is to say, if he wants to do a devotional service unto a Bhagavata or unto a devotee like Bharata, the devotion or the devotional service to Rama becomes an impediment. Why? Because if we have to serve a spiritual master and at that time we have to serve the Lord also simultaneously, one is an impediment for the other. However, we know that serving the Lord gives us an opportunity to serve the Bhagavata. But Shatrughna's mood was always to serve Bharata, who is serving Lord Ramchandra. Because Krishna and Kulashekar Alwar also says in Mukunda Mala Stotra, Tava Vrittasya 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 Itimam Smaram Lokanata. And I am actually a servant of your servant of your servant. So Shatrughno, Nitya Shatrughno, Niti Preeti Puraskritaha. So this is how he mentions the introduction of leaving of the two great personalities within Ramayana, who is Bharata and Shatrughna. Interestingly, if you actually see the first word of Ayodhya Kanda, the first verse, first word, it's called Gacchata. Gacchata in Sanskrit means they left. Very beautifully, Valmiki has thought over this and used this as the first word. As I said, Akshaya means never ending. You can go to every word of Valmiki Ramayana and appreciate it totally. Gacchata means left. what happens gachata first gachata he is mentioning bharata and shatrughna left the kingdom second gachata normal we know that later in the past times of ayodhya kanda rama will leave ayodhya and go to the forest gachata third dasharatha will no longer be the king he will go to heavenly planets or vaikuntha so gachata he will go to call rama he will tell sumantra you please go and call we are going to see that today gachata sumantra goes ayodhya vasis will leave their houses and follow ramachandra gachata bharata who was supposed to be the next higher apparent will leave ayodhya and also go gachata and from chitrakoot he will be told to come back again he has to come gachata so all these points of view keeping in mind valmiki has given the first word gachata matrukulam bharatena tadanaga this is the beauty of unending wonderful descriptions given by our acharyas so whenever we read ramayana we should understand that every word that has been chosen by valmiki and by our acharyas they are not a fluke they are not coming just out of the hat they have been used with a pinpointed precision and those are the highest peak of ecstasies relished by these great sages and great acharyas if we can even get a glimpse even a drop of those ecstasies our life is completely satisfied our life is completely successful thinking about such a life which is successful or not the great poet called Kalidasa writes a verse in Raghuvamsham in fact Kalidasas and many other poets within India they are very great poets and they have written magnificent works if somebody is interested in Sanskrit and they want to learn more about Sanskrit they should pick up these works and these works are much much greater than the Shakespeare's of the world and the August Nightingales of the world and the modern poets that people speak about so highly from the English language please understand I am not putting English language down it is a very mode of communication that we are speaking however the great language of Sanskrit and the epitome of their creations are just wonderful so Kalidasa mentions what happened to Dasharatha in the Ayodhya Kanda he mentions very beautifully he mentions that Dasharatha had a lot of time he was the king now 12 years had passed his son and his daughter-in-law are staying together with him everything is happy and glorious so he had lot of time no he had lot of time because he was an able administrator what that means that the leader of the country or the leader of that Kosala kingdom was such an able administrator that he had the pakka ministers with him he had the perfect ministers to do all their duties not only he had the ministers were not at all corrupt and they used to execute their duties in a very wonderful way and hence there was peace reigning in the kingdom the people the janas were very happy they were very ecstatic with the fact of Dasharatha's kingdom which was staying so while everybody did his job Dasharatha had a lot of free time for himself so one day he went to take a bath and he after taking a bath he came and stood before a mirror and when he stood before the mirror he took a comb and started combing his hair something which is very difficult in these days of lockdown I was just talking the other day to my parents and they were mentioning that it has become so difficult that now it seems like the jata which we wanted to have for so many days the lockdown is enabling us that is why you see a lot of hair growing on everybody's head and we are waiting for the saloons and others to open but back in those days Dasharatha had the benefit of keeping long hairs the rajas had the dharmas of keeping some beard some long hair however it is suggested that those who are studying Vedas those who are studying scriptures they generally should not have long side locks I remember once my mother saying that when she was studying in college, at that time there were great cricketers, and there was one cricketer who used to have an extensive side lock, and people used to worship him as so much. But when she came back home, her father was mentioning that those who had Vedic patashalas, they are not supposed to keep side locks long. In fact, they should have no side locks at all, because that is seen as a bodily comfort. Why I am saying this is because you can see that the previous generations also, they were adept in knowing the very small instances of Vedic knowledge. And this is very important that the elders are always present us to tweak our ears and tell us what you should do and what you should not do. That helps us. Maybe we will not learn it at the age of 10. Maybe we will not learn it at the age of 14. But when we reach our 30s and 31s and 32s, or when we reach our 40s and 50s and sometimes 60s, we can really appreciate the golden snippets and words what our parents and our elders have spoken. So just like that, Dasharatha was combing his hair. And while he was combing his hair, there was one gray hair. Remember, Dasharatha never used any dye products. Godrej dye was not made in Kosala kingdom. When the Jara or the old age was supposed to come, only at that time, the blackish hair will turn white. That was the dharma. That even the hair on the body will follow the dharma of the Samudrika Shastra, which is there. So while Dasharatha was combing, for 60,000 years he was living, and for 60,000 years in front of the mirror, he never saw a gray hair. Something which we cannot even imagine now. Even 15, 16 year olds have white hair on their body right now. So we cannot even imagine how Dasharatha, or we can only think about the great coconut oil that Dasharatha would have been making in Ayodhya kingdom, which kept the hair black. So he was actually combing his hair, and there was this one white hair which was little long, and it was touching his ear. So you imagine one hair from the top of the temple, it is actually long enough, and it was touching the ear of Dasharatha. How do I know this? Because Kalidasa says this in Raghuvamsham very beautifully. Tam karna moolam agatya ramer shirnasya tammiti. Says, tam. What does he say? So he says that tam karna moolam agatya. Karna means the, not the Mahabharata karna. Karna means the ear. Tam karna moolam, it comes to up to the tip of the ear, agatya, it has come. And what is this hair doing? It is actually whispering into the ears of Dasharatha. Prabhuji, what is this? How can a hair actually whisper? A hair is like a dead matter. When it falls down, I cannot talk to my hair. Otherwise, in every barber shop, when I go to cut my hair and my hair falls down, I will pick it up and I will keep talking to it. Hey, beautiful. Hey, wonderful hair. How are you doing? How were you sitting on the top? I cannot talk to the hair like that. So how come the hair is talking to Dasharatha? Please understand, this is a poem. In poem, certain similes, at the same time, there is something called as Atishayokti Alankars, similes, metaphors. For example, if I have to say, today you all joined Zoom. That means I am actually saying it like a normal person. You all were sitting in your houses. You have clicked on the link and you have joined Zoom. I cannot be a poet and I cannot speak it in this way. If I am a poet and I have to describe the same event, I have to say something very differently. That beautiful, that gem-studded, beautiful tablet that you have in front of your house, which has beautiful resplendent keys. On that you kept your lotus-like finger and touched on the bluish, emeraldish colored link, which opened up a different dimension in which you can see a very bad looking person trying to speak to you, Ayodhya Kanda. So this is how I have to speak, a simple joining a Zoom session, if I have to speak it like a poet. So poets are allowed this ability to not only exaggerate, not it's not exaggerate that it is a false or a lie, it is a truth, but they have the liberty to use similes and metaphors. And the other reason our acharya gives is that everything in the spiritual world has a conscience. Even the metal pot or the vase which is kept has conscience. Everything in Vrindavan has a conscience, and everything is conscious. They are not dead matter. So even it might seem like it is inanimate in nature, but here even that is supporting the cause of Rama's Leela. So Kalidasa says, Tam karna moolam agatya, this hair, this gray, one gray white hair is coming actually to the tip of the ear, and it is whispering something. Now why it has to whisper? Why cannot it say shoutingly? Valmiki gives that also as a reason. Some secrets, some inner desires in our heart, they actually whisper to our mind. They don't come outside and keep a loudspeaker and say, today I want gulab jamun. No. This desire actually comes from the heart and it whispers in the mind. The mind processes it, the intelligence looks at it, and then the sense objects gives it to the person who is cooking food. Check, make gulab jamun, make paneer, make whatever. So these are desires, and hence the karna moolam, the hair actually wanted to plant the desire in the heart of Dasharatha. Because Dasharatha should not tomorrow feel that some desire has been planted in me. It is not my desire. It is my hair's desire. So he didn't want to do that. So this particular hair went and whispered in the ear of Dasharatha. What did he whisper? What was the contents of the whisper? Kalidasa zooms in, keeps a microphone, keeps a tapping machine between Dasharatha's ears and the hair which is whispering this sound, and he says, Ramer Shirnasyatamiti. Ramer, he uttered the name Ram. So Dasharatha understood something about Ram is what this hair is saying. Shirnasya, please give this kingdom to Rama. Don't you see I have turned white? Don't you see you have become old? It's been 60,000 years. Now it is the time for you to give this kingdom to Rama. Shirnasya tam iti. So please execute this and give this kingdom to Lord Ramachandra. Now we all might think, what a wonderful service this hair has done. But Kalidasa, he is very great. Immediately, once the desire has been planted, the mind, as Srila Prabhupada says, has two qualities, likes and dislike. It is a constant generator of thoughts. It always generates thoughts. It never takes a decision. For example, you all are walking through the street and suddenly you see many shops. Nowadays it is lockdown, all the shops are closed. So our mind is controlled. But imagine a situation when the lockdown is lifted. You have been staying so many days inside the house, and next day when the lockdown is lifted, Mr. Modi has said all the business can go as normal as it was before 2 months, and you are walking down the street. First shop you will see gulab jamun, paneer, others. Second job, garam samosas. What will happen? Our mind will say, 1 month we have not eaten gulab jamun, let us go to it. 2 steps you take forward, you will see a samosa shop, samosa. 3 steps ahead, vada pav, vada pav. All those things that you have not seen and not enjoyed for 2 months, the mind will constantly feed us with desires. But on the other side, there will be one part of us, which is the intelligence, which will say, no, this is not good for you. 2 months you stayed without it. You are now healthy and fit. Why do you want to go back to this? This is not good. Second, it will say, on Akshaya Tritiya day, we heard that all food should be offered as prasadam. This is not prasadam. Why should we eat? This is the role of intelligence. Intelligence takes the decision whether to do this activity or not. Whether this is favorable for our Krishna conscious or not. Whether this should be accepted or rejected. This is the function of intelligence. Whichever is strong, suppose mind is strong, then the activity of mind will take place. If intelligence is strong, activity of intelligence will take place. Hence it is suggested we read Shastra, which is like Shastra, which is like a weapon to sharpen our intelligence. When we sharpen our intelligence, it can easily overpower the mind and it will tell the mind shut up. And when we tell the mind to shut up, then we are walking in our path of Krishna consciousness. We are not neglecting the mind. We are telling and training the mind, for which we chant Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. So the mind is always, why I'm saying this is, it's a random generator of thoughts. It will only think about likes and dislikes. Now that the hare has whispered into Dasharatha's ear, Dasharatha has liked this desire, and it is a thought which is coming in his mind that let me go and make Rama the next higher apparent, next president elect, next king elect. But at the same time, the mind also gives the next thought. Kaikeyi Shankayeva vaha, Kaikeyi Shankayeva vaha, Parichachat Manajaram. He thinks immediately of the next person. Who is that person? Kaikeyi. Look at the desire. One desire is Rama has to become the king. Immediately the next desire that comes is, oh my God, Kaikeyi. What will I do of Kaikeyi? What is that I can do of Kaikeyi? Now that I have become old, that lady is impossible to manage. So immediately there is tension also, and at the same time there is happiness as well. This is the unfortunate situation that Dasharatha is going through. But nevertheless, he thinks this desire is good. Let me take an action on it. No, he does not take an action on it. He says, it might be my decision, but it is my utmost responsibility that I actually go and find out, not only me, what is my other people actually thinking about this? I might be thinking that I need to give the kingdom to my son. But is this the same thought that others are having? This is real democracy. Nowadays, we are saying we are in a democratic country where it is for the people, by the people, to the people. But actually, we see that in the current politics scenario, it is more hereditary, more ancestry, that the same family is ruling the kingdom than anybody else coming in. And that foreign person coming and staying and taking over, which is in Kaikeyi, is still applicable in many countries that we see. So it is not something which is very new. So there, the real democracy, though it was the king's son who is getting elected, but still the king wants to go and ask others, take their opinion, feeling that I might be wrong, let me talk about others. So King Dasharatha, what he did was he called for all the sages and all the brahmanas and all the Ayodhyavasis and all the ministers. He called them together and he started addressing them. Valmiki says it beautifully, that when all of them were called, they all came together to the assembly, took their seats. The seats of Dasharatha was like a great throne embedded with many rubies, lapis lazulis, and many other diamonds. And there Dasharatha was sitting and he was looking at his great Sabha, the Kosala Sabha, and he addressed them with these words. Soham Vishrami Michami Putram Kritva Prajahite Sannikrishta Niman Sarvan Anumanya Dvijarashrabhan Anujato Himam Sarvai Gunai Jeshto Mamatajaha Purandarasmo Vidye Ramam Param Puranjayaha. The first verse he says, look, I have ruled this kingdom for 60,000 years. Hence, I think it is time for me to take rest. Vishram Ichami, I want to take rest. Then you should take rest. You should take rest when we have worked very hard labor, and not for one day, half a day. We are supposed to take rest when we have worked hard for a long time. Suppose in the whole 5 days we have done extensive workout, Sunday you can take rest, we'll say your gym trainer. So we'll have to take one day rest, because even the trainer knows that unless your body comes back to normal, you cannot do exercise for next 5 days. So Vishram Ichami, after a long arduous work of maintaining this great Ishwaku dynasty, I now feel that for the benefit of the people, Kritva Prajahite, I am not doing this for myself. I am doing it for my praja, and hence I have called the praja here, and I want to create an open ballot and understand whether what I am doing is correct or wrong. Kritva prajahite sannikrishtan iman sarva anumanya dvija arshabhan. So the best brahmanas, the dvijas, dvijas means twice born, one who is born twice. First he is born from the mother's womb. Then when he gets the Brahma Gayatri in his ears from his father and the spiritual master, he becomes twice born. Dvija sometimes in Sanskrit is also used for birth of birds, because they first fall from their mother and then they are again born from the egg. Hence they are called dvijas. Dvija is also told for the teeth, because first you get milk teeth and then you get wisdom teeth. So you have to be very careful where the word dvija comes. Sometimes it might be used for teeth, sometimes it might be used for a bird, sometimes it might be used for brahmanas. So here in this case it is brahmanas. Hence sometimes when Krishna speaks, that they say the dvija has spoken, that means his small milky teeth has started speaking some words when the tongue is hitting the small milk teeth of Krishna. Sometimes when Garuda flies, they say the dvija has flown. That means the bird which was first in the egg and then born from the mother and then born from the egg. Hence he is called dvija. But here they are the brahmanas, because they are the sacred thread wearers. So here it is said that he asked this question to all the Ayodhya Vasis. What did he say? My eldest son Rama. Anujato hi mam sarva gunai jeshto mamatmajaha. My eldest son Rama is actually equal to Devendra in valor. And he is the conqueror of cities and enemies, because everybody knew about Tataka's story. Everybody knew about Subahu's story. Everybody knew how he protected Vishwamitra's yajna. It was very well written in his resume. So he said he is the great protector, and hence I feel that this kingdom should be given to him. What do you think? Now, the way of feedback is also very important. Many people, after their lectures have seen, they ask, how did you find the lecture? Good or bad? Now, this is a very bad way of asking a question, because there are only two choices that the person should say, either good or either bad. Maybe they have so many more things to say. Prabhuji, the first part was good. Second part was very boring. Third part was absolutely nonsense. I couldn't understand anything that you spoke. Maybe they'll say, all this was good, but you could have added this and that, and that could have made the Ramayana much better. So when you give the liberty to the person to answer, not objectively in gray, black and white, saying this is good, this is bad. When you give the opportunity of feedback a little more larger, okay, what do you think about it? Do you feel that something can be improved? Do you feel that it is, if you ask a question like that, it enables the person to give an answer in a much better way. This is being highlighted by Dasharatha. He did not ask, should I give Rama the kingdom or not? No, he said no. He said, I am asking you this question. Please understand, don't take my word as the best word. I can be wrong. This is my desire. You use your intelligence. You tell me all the Sabhaganas who are being stationed here on my calling. Please take your time and take the liberty to give me extensively the reasons why you think Rama should be made the king, if you are supporting the motion. And if you are declining the motion, saying that Rama should not become the king, please tell me why he should not become the king. But before you say that, first say which section you are from. That means either you are standing for the proposal that Rama should become the king, or either you are against the proposal that Rama should not become the king. This was the question which was put forward by Dasharatha. When this question was put forward by Dasharatha, together, unanimously, the answer came from the Sabhaganas. All the Rishis, Munis and the great Ayodhya Vasis, they said one of the most beautiful shlokas in Ayodhya Kanda. And we should hear that shloka. And when Dasharatha asked, Yadya esha mama priti hirtamanyad vichintayam anaya madayas sat chindinta hi viramadhabi dikodayam. This is my desire. So he says, please tell me what is your. Then the Ayodhya Vasis say, इच्छामोहि महाबाहुम रघुवीरम महाबलम गजेन महता यांताम रामम छत्रवृतानम. Every word in this shloka is beautiful. First word that the Ayodhyavasis say is Ichha Mohi. Ichha means desire. But they use a word called as He. He means only. Once I was hearing this lecture from Gokulesha Prabhu many years back. In fact, he has been like the foundational person who's been teaching this epithets of knowledge to me. One of the points that he very beautifully said one day, back in 2002, 2003, still resonates in my mind. He gave us a small question. He asked, who is the Supreme Personality of Godhead? This was a question in a question paper of a Bhagavatam lecture. We all wrote Krishna. But there was one devotee amongst our mates. I think it's Ram Giridhari Prabhu. He wrote in that answer, Krishna only. So he got the full marks and everybody else got only half mark. And the whole lecture was on how that word only is so important. Look, it is very important to say, suppose the wife comes and asks the husband, do you love me? It's important to say, I love you only as my wife. Because if you don't use the word only, that means there are many other wives which I am interested in. That is not the case. The only is most important. The Krishna is the Supreme Personality of Godhead. So in generally the Shastras, we have two ways of using this word called as only. And what is this word called as only? Suppose some person says, Rama is the archer only. That means Rama is not a doctor. Rama is not an engineer. Rama is not residing in Chita camp. Rama is archer only. So if you actually take up all the skill sets, Rama knows archery the best. This is what it means. But if you say Rama is the only archer, that means everybody else who does archery are not doing archery. It is only Rama who is actually doing the best archer. If you have to call somebody a great archer, one who is executing bows and arrows, it has to be only Rama. So the word usage of only is very important. And many places in Shastras, we will use this word only. And here Ayodhya Vasis are using it at the right time. Ichha mohi hi. That means we can only desire. What does that mean? Who is the king? You are the king. We are only the subjects. We can desire, but the activity has to be done by you. We see that in many countries. Many people desire so many things, but the topmost leader of the country does not desire, means it doesn't get executed. So the people can only come back and say, I told this to the government, but the government did not execute it. So similarly, the Ayodhya Vasis are also saying, Ichha Mohi, we don't have the power, but you have the power, Dasharatha. So what is that they are saying? Ichha Mohi Mahabahum. They are addressing Dasharatha as Mahabahum. Bahum means one who has great strength and one who has long arms. Mahabahum. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, when he comes in the Chaitanya Leela, there is a beautiful song. Ajanu Lambita Bahu Jugala Kanaka Putali Deha. Ajanu Lambita. One's hands are as long as they are touching the knees. Ajanu Lambita Bahu Jugala. So he's Bahu means actually arms. And here the Ayodhyavasi is saying, Mahabahum, O Dasharatha, you have long hands. Were you thinking actually why you have long hands? You had these long hands because you wanted to coronate Rama with that crown of Ayodhya. And you had to actually reach out to the top of his head, for which you have to extend and carry the weight of the crown. That is why the Lord has given you Mahabahum. So indirectly they are mentioning their wish. Ichha Mohi, we can only desire. Mahabahum, you have got these long hands because you should coronate. And what else are they saying? They are saying Ichha Mohi Mahabahum Raghuviram Mahabalam. Raghuviram, he is a Veera of Raghu dynasty. is one of the greatest personality. Mahabalam, we have heard about his prowess against killing of Tataka. We have heard about his prowess against Subahu and Maricha. So I think Ichhamohi Mahabahum Raguviram Mahabalam. And then he says, Gajena Mahatam Yantam Ramam Chatravritananam. We all desire Gajena Mahatam Yantam. Gajena, that royal elephant of Ayodhya. So Dasharatha had a favorite elephant. And this elephant's name is also given by Valmiki. So this name of Dasharatha's elephant is Shrutanjaya. So this elephant, please remember the name Shrutanjaya. So everybody is saying that elephant Shrutanjaya. Every day we are bored seeing you, Dasharatha, on the top of that elephant. Now we want to see our beloved Ramachandra on top of that elephant. Gajam Yantam Vritananam. And then he says, because you are sitting on top of the Ayodhya kingdom and on top of the elephant, the sun will be scorchingly happy because he is coming in the lineage of the sun. And hence the sun will be happy. When the sun is happy, he is going to smile. And when he is going to smile, the rays of the sun are going to hit the crown of Lord Ramchandra with a maximum daze. And sometimes he might sweat. So what we want is, we want that royal umbrella to be put on top of him so that he doesn't feel that scorching heat, which is actually the blessings of the Sun dynasty. Chatravritananam, the royal umbrella should be on top. With one verse, how beautifully Valmiki has spoken the Ayodhya Vasi's desire. That we cannot do it. This is our desire. You have been befitting enough to do this. And we want Rama to be in the asking. But Dasharatha does not agree. Dasharatha says, no, this seems to be a simple reason. Tell me more reasons why Ramchandra should become the king. I will only accept when you tell me more reasons why Ramchandra should be given the kingdom. So they say, Dasharatha will tell you the first reason. You have been always inside the Kosala kingdom quarters. You never come outside and see the reality. You are the king in the king's palace. No offense to you. You have been ruling the kingdom nicely. We are very happy. But you know what Rama used to do? Whenever he knows that some Ayodhya Vasi in trouble, he is the prince. He can actually clap his hands and 40 people can stand in front of him and execute the service, whatever he wants. He is the prince. He can command and he can make the people do. But never we have seen Rama commanding people. If he wants to learn something, he will actually walk down his palace stairs. He will not speak to anyone that he is the prince. He will not show his garva, the pride that he is the prince. While he is passing by, he will speak to the guard, ask him, is everything all right? Is your bhabhi all right? Are your sons all right? He will talk to them and they will feel happy throughout the day. Dasharatha, when you passed by, you never used to speak to the guards. But Rama speaks to every guard. He knows every person's name. And then when he used to go into the chariot driver will be standing opening the gates of the chariot. He'll say, no need, I will open it myself. He will open it to us himself. Sometimes he will not take the chariot. All the people will be walking towards the temple. He will be one amongst us walking towards the temple along with us on foot. And whenever he wants to learn something from the Ayodhya Vasis, he will go to that particular place and fall at the feet of the elder. He's the prince. He's falling at the feet of the elder. Sit there in that house, not on the throne, but on the floor, and sit with folded hands and learn the art, the science, the music, the knowledge, everything from that person. So he is such a humble person that he actually goes house by house, one place by place, and he is humility personified. Not only that, Dasharatha, let me tell you some additional qualities of Lord Ramchandra. Whenever some people are old in our family and we cannot attend to them, and we might be thinking, who will take care of them? The prince of Ayodhya, Lord Ramchandra, will come to our house and take care of the old people. He will stay next to them. Sometimes he will sleep in our house. Sometimes he, at the young age, has sat on my grandfather's lap and has eaten the prasad. You know, can you imagine the prince of Kosala doing all this? We have not heard you. So he is such a great personality. So you should make him the king. You know what Dasharatha says? I don't think this is also a right reason. Because you know what? You are in front of me. And in front of the king, you will always do flattery for your son. Just because you are in front of me, you are speaking about Ramchandra the Great. Maybe behind my back, you will speak something else. Though that was never the culture of Ayodhya Vasis. So then Ayodhya Vasis thought, let us give the real reason why Rama should become the king. And he said the most beautiful verses. The Ayodhya Vasis said, actual reason why Rama should become the king, you know, because he has got a very good wife, Mother Sita. And when Dasharatha heard that, he said, this reason I will accept. I have got a great daughter-in-law, who is the real resplendent person with qualities in total, and hence Rama is her husband, so let us make him the king. So actually in this, Valmiki also showcases that how much is the importance of a wife in a man's life. The wife is the epitome. In fact, she walks shoulder to shoulder with the husband if she is of a sound nature and if she is spiritually enlightened. In fact, she can be the greatest friend that the husband can have. Because she walks shoulder to shoulder and helps know the husband that what's right and what's wrong. And this is for devotee families as well. So here, the Ayodhya Vasis are beautifully saying, because Mother Sita is the wife of Lord Ramchandra, hence he is capable of becoming the king. And Dasharatha was very happy because he knew the glories of Mother Sita. In fact, you will be surprised. Nowadays, people are fighting for equality. Nowadays, people are fighting that there is a lot amount of home violence against women. In fact, and this was prevalent from time immemorial. No, this was not prevalent from time immemorial. If you actually read Sundarakanda, which we'll come to in some time, when Hanuman asks, please tell me, O Mate, are you the real Sita? When she is sitting below the Ashoka Vatika, you know what? How the introduction and the Aadhaar card of Sita, she begins. She says, yes, I am the real Sita. I am the Sita. Who am I? I'll give you my introduction. First thing she says, I am the daughter-in-law of Dasharatha. This is the first introduction she gives. Then she says, I am the daughter of Janaka. And then he says, maybe this introduction is enough. If it is not enough, I will give you the third introduction. I am also the wife of Lord Ramchandra. Now look at this beautiful narration. Not only Dasharatha accepts her as the true daughter-in-law, the daughter-in-law also says, I am actually the daughter-in-law of my father-in-law, who is none other than Dasharatha. Such was the close relationships. Such was the peak of epitome of relationships, where the Ayodhya Vasis tell Dasharatha that nothing doing, please elect Lord Ramchandra as the king. And I think that is how you should go about it. Dasharatha is very happy hearing these wonderful anecdotes of Ramchandra. But at the same time, he is very worried about one person who is there in his kingdom, who is none other than Kaikeyi. Because Kaikeyi at the same point of time is generally depicted, not only generally, she is depicted as somebody who is a little selfish. Now, when I say this, many people again knock at my doors and ask this question. Why is that, Prabhu, you are actually denouncing a woman? May because Kaikeyi actually had seen that Rama might be doing a Brahmahatya, so she found it right that Rama should go to the forest. Hence, what she asked for is right. Many people will come back and protest against the characteristics portrayed in Kaikeyi. We have so many books and authors who have been winning medals and awards because they are writing that Ravana is very good. In fact, there are movies made in South India where Ravana is actually not the anti-villain, he is actually considered as hero. Many people are writing Ramayana from the perspective of Ravana. Now, this is all nonsense. Why? Because, of course, Ravana was a great king. Administratively, he was administrating Lanka very beautifully. not spoken by me, not spoken by Valmiki. Hanuman is saying this. Hanuman in Sundarakanda, when he goes across the cities of Lanka, he says, how will my Ramachandra come and attack the city? It is so beautifully administered, says Hanuman. And Hanuman also says he plays Veena very nicely. He has got Dashamukha. He is an ardent devotee of Lord Shiva. But he had one false quality, that is to be interested in other person's wife. Now that brought the entire distress in Ravana's qualities. Hence, he will always remain a villain. Whereas Ramachandra, when Mandodari was approaching, he moved 3 steps back, not even to let the shadow of Ramachandra touch the shadow of Mandodari. Where Mandodari says, now I understood where my husband failed, you have won. Hence, by killing him, you have done the right job. That is the character of Lord Ramachandra. So, while many people feel Kaikeyi is wrongly portrayed, no. Let us look at what Kaikeyi has been said by his own son. Bharata, when he comes back, we will see in Ayodhya Kanda tomorrow or today evening, when he actually comes back, he says, Atmakama Sadachandi Krodaya Pragyamalini. These are the words he uses for his mother. Atmakama, always self-centered. Sada Chandi, always very short-tempered. Krodaya, very short-tempered. Sada Chandi, always selfish and prestige-conscious. Pragyamalini, very selfish lady. So when Valmiki and Bharata, who had observed Kaikeyi in close quarters, are giving this as the definition, why should we pick up new definitions and say, what do you think, Kaikeyi? Why are you putting it this way? And we are seeing Dasharatha also thinking about it. So Ayodhya Vasis have said Rama should become the king. And at the same time, Dasharatha is thinking, how will Kaikeyi react? These both are going on in his mind. He immediately calls for his minister, who is none other than Sumantra. And Sumantra is called. Sumantra is told, please go immediately and bring Lord Ramachandra. Sumantra leaves in a beautiful chariot. Ayodhya Vasis are very happy. Now is the time we will see Dasharatha and Rama together in the royal assembly. Sumantra goes all the way, goes inside the palace, the beautiful 3-gated palace of Lord Ramachandra. Lord Rama is sitting there. Mother Sita is also there. But at the same time, he speaks to Rama alone that your father has called you. When he hears this, in fact, Sumantra says the most beautiful words, your father has called you right now to the royal assembly. Would you wish to come now? Rama actually gets a hurt in his heart. Now, if somebody comes and asks us this question, we'll feel happy. Okay, we might come, we may not come. Tell 5 minutes, 2 minutes, I'm getting my car out. My driver has not come. Something we will say. But Rama was very unhappy. Unhappy in the sense that he was hurt. Not he was unhappy. He was hurt. Because Sumantra added the words, would you wish to come now? Because Rama said, my whole life is supposed to be only following my father's orders. If my father says A, I will do A. If my father says B, I will do B. So if my father has ordered, that means there is a reason. Hence, I should execute. Let's go right now. So they travel in that chariot. All the Ayodhya Vasis are happy to see Lord Ramachandra going from his palace to Dasharatha's palace. It's like a Rath Yatra. Every day they are looking forward to this sight. Every day they will be washing some vegetables, putting different rangolis in front of their house, talking to each other, talking to the neighbors. But when Rama's chariot goes, everybody will stand up and look at his lotus-like face, and Rama will be smiling, giving them darshan, and they love this scene happening in front of their eyes, and they will be very happy. And when this goes, Rama immediately gets down, Vasishtha gets down and opens the chariot, Sumantra gets down and opens the chariot for Ramachandra. And Valmiki mentions the stairs of the Kosala kingdom. Imagine the first description that we gave. The stairs are very long. The stairs of the Kosala kingdom and all the guards whom he knows by the name, he looks at them, smiles at them, but he's going with an elephant gait as if he is going to get the kingdom now, and he's climbing up the stairs one by one. Valmiki says the stairs are as if they are Mount Sumeru by itself. They are that huge. And with a brisk walk, he is actually climbing the stairs and he enters the royal sabha. At that time, all the faces turn towards it. The sun is beaming through the windows, and here is the king elect, who is Ramachandra, walking to understand what his father is going to say. He takes his steps, and when he takes his step, everybody takes his lotus feet in their hearts, and they're very happy to see. Dasharatha is very happy to see Lord Ramachandra arrive at the court, and whenever he comes near Ramachandra, when Ramachandra comes near Dasharatha, he immediately pays his full obeisances and says the beautiful shlokas of Abhivadaye. Now, this is a customary activity. When people meet elders in the Vedic custom, they actually hold both their hands and they give an introduction. The introduction actually says from which gotra they are, which sage they are in an ancestral lineage, from where do they come, what is the Vedas that they study. So this and all is taught in the Vedic samskaras. Like they say, Abhivadaye Angirasa Bahurspritya Bharadvaja Trayorasheha Pravaranite Apastam Sutraha Yajur Shakha Dhyayi Shri, and you have to put your name. You have to put Haridasa Varya, you have to put Kodandarama, you have to put Achyutarama, whatever is your name. Aham Asmin Boh, you will actually do the Abhivadaye, where you give the full, I am from the Angirasa Kong, I am from the Bharadwaja Gotra, I am actually studying Yajur Shakha, and I have been studying the third Chandas, and I have reached up to here, and my name is so and so. Please accept my humble obeisances. This is the great quality. And here Valmiki says, Ramachandra did that in front of Dasharatha. Dasharatha immediately got up and lifted his son and gave a beautiful throne. And he announced to Lord Ramachandra that you are elected as the next heir apparent. For a second, imagine if we are in Ramachandra's place. We would have immediately jumped up, picked up our mobile phone, gone to facebook.com, and you would have written the first thing in our comment and wall box, next heir apparent, yes, I am the king. And you would have got 400 likes, 200 dislikes, whatever you might have got. Ramachandra did not move an inch. Shitoshna samadukhada. He was equipoised at that position. He was just gently smiling. But Valmiki says he was happy to hear he was the next heir apparent. And he was announced that he's the next heir apparent. He was equipoised. He was taking in happiness as it comes. And he was blooming like a lotus. He did not speak a word in that sabha. And when he was spoken, he just paid his obeisances to his father. And his father took the leave. And he also left to go and inform Mother Kausalya. So this is what happened, and everybody again looked at Lord Ramachandra when he went back from the Sabha. This was a transcendental pastime from morning to evening. So morning the Sabha was called, and evening also there was a Sabha called. What happened in the evening Sabha, let us also see in the evening. So we will stop our katha here because it's exactly 1 hour. So with that, we have moved into Ayodhya Kanda, where Rama has been broken this news that it is the wish of Ayodhya Vasis that you become the king. Will he really become the king? Will there be a change of mind? What will happen next is something that we'll see at 8:30 p.m. today. Mangalam Kausalendraya Maganiya Gunaptane Chakravarti Tanujaya Sarvagomaya Mangalam Srimate Raghuviraya Sedulla Sindhave Dhritarashtrajaya Ranadhiraya Mangalam Asadhyam Navendivyam Abhishaktaya Sitayam Rajadi Rajadi Raja Ramaputraya Mangalam. So if there are any questions or comments, we can discuss. Hare Krishna.